Evening, everyone. This is Dorothea from Airpus Creations 2021. And it's late in the evening, but I nevertheless made it. I made it. I'm happy I made it. And what do you think we do in this video? Well, I thought I like to talk about Confucius and the writings of Confucius and the meaning of the philosophy of Confucius. So I read old notes, I looked through books, and I ended up with how many pages? With 13 pages of the most relevant things that I like to share with all of you, introducing Confucius. And when we talk about Confucius, we have to also talk about the Analects. The Analects of Confucius, here they are, the Analects of Confucius, and they have all things in there that are important with regards to Confucius's philosophy. They talk about Confucius, about ancient times, about his disciples, about terms and traditions and rituals and things like that. It's not a really that big a book, but it has nevertheless lots of things in there. And if you like to learn things about Confucius, this is the book you have to read without any doubt. This is of course not the original writing from Confucius, but a translation, an English translation, one of the best translations from Arthur Whaley. Arthur Whaley, and my teacher picked that book for us. Okay, so it was the first semester for me in my whole life that I took. It was 1994. The semester started January the 16th and went till April the 24th in 1994. It was a very compact and a very kind of difficult semester, because not only the subject matter, but also all the different dynasties, the Chinese dynasties and the Chinese special meanings and special words that were kind of, well, unusual. But I made it through there, and I found it in the end very interesting. That's why I want to share it with you, because we all heard from Confucius. We all heard maybe some sayings that people used, but we never really had a broad picture of his philosophy. So I thought, well, I like to share it, okay? Because my new channel will be about that. I like to share different philosophies, different religions, the world religions that I studied. I like to introduce those to my viewers so they can get a little taste about the differences between, let's say, Hinduism and Sikhism, things like that. I thought are kind of interesting, even if a person is not religious in that broader sense, but it's kind of nice to learn the things nevertheless. So this is what I'm intending from now on to do in my channel. So shall we start? Okay, I read a lot because, as I said, the dynasties, the names I cannot remember, and I also wrote such stuff down to get it right. So I have to use my notes so that I don't make a mistake and tell you the wrong things, okay? So please forgive me for using the notes to tell you the things that I think are interesting and that you might want to learn. So we'll start now, okay? There are 5 books, the classics, they are called the classics with regard to Chinese thought. These books are the Book of Changes, the Book of History, the Book of Odes, the Book of Rites, and the Spring and Autumn Annals. These 5 books teach us philosophy and religion of Confucianism. 4 other books are also important, and these 4 other books are the Analects, a Book of Mencius, the Book of Great Learning, and the Doctrine of the Mean. The Doctrine of the Mean has nothing to do with being mean or the word mean or the meaning of being mean. The Doctrine of the Mean means an harmonized way of everything, an equal take. That's the mean of the Doctrine of the Mean, okay? The 4 books, these 4 books are philosophical writings and sayings. The Book of Great Learning, as well as the Doctrine of the Mean, have sayings from the Analects. There is also an additional book called the Book of Songs, which has writings about court pieces and government. The Book of Song is also an important book in the Christian Bible for those who maybe studied a little bit Christianity or read a little bit in the Bible, will know that our Christian Bible in the Old Testament has also a book called the Book of Songs. That maybe is the reason why my Jewish teacher liked so much Confucius. It's a speculation on my part, but it could be that he saw some similarities between Jewish thought and Confucianism by sharing the same name for a book, like the Book of Songs. The Book of Songs in the Christian Bible, as I said, is found in the Old Testament and so belongs to the Jewish tradition. When we think or talk about Confucius, we mostly refer to the Analects. The Analects are generally regarded as I said, the Confucian Bible. It is a miscellaneous, unclassified, and unedited collection of the remarks of Confucius on various occasions, mostly without any suggestions as to the circumstances in which the remarks were made, and they are certainly often torn from their context. The Confucian Bible can be seen like the Greek writings of Homer, or the Quran of Islam, or the Bible of Christianity. When we look at the teachings of Confucius, we find out that there are 3 main meanings which are very important. There is the Way, there is Te, and there is Li. All these 3 words are important. The way refers to better morals of old days. Te refers to a moral force. And li refers to doing the right thing by appropriate behavior in every part of life and also by following rituals. Because Confucius was a traditionalist and a humanist, the way was very important to him. He felt that people did not follow the way anymore, that they had left the way of old and became, let's say, very immoral and kind of bad in governing different states, that the rulers were no longer moral rulers and people also were not very good anymore. And he wanted to change that. It was a matter of his heart. He liked to bring back old days, old ways, old traditions, to make all the different states, provinces, and places better again. Confucius was interested in government, and he also worked in government, and he hoped to bring change by implementing his way of doing philosophy and implementing more morality in society again. Confucius was born 551 BC in Lu, in the province of Shang, which is a peninsula in the north that was called the Land of the Dead. He is interested in the Duke of Shu, who founded the province in which he lived. Confucius was very interested in history, the Chinese dynasties, their divine kings, and he considered himself living under the Shu dynasty. Confucius also believed in ancestor worship. Because Confucius lives at the end of the Shu dynasty, he lives not in very orderly times. At that time, the society started to move away from the old days, old ways, from the moral upbringing that he had as a kid, and he liked to restore it and bring it back so that life in China would be like the old ways, like they were meant to be, as he felt, and they should just do the same things which were always done, which he liked, and so that was the goal of his philosophical work. He wanted to bring back the way where a king, an emperor, a higher person had to follow the proper way of ruling the country, so he would also promote good people. Confucius felt, if we had leaders that adhere to morals and they adhere to the way of old, then they would also teach the common person to do likewise and then society would return back to the perfect way, as he felt, the perfect way of the ancestors who did everything better than the modern times. That for him, somehow he felt, was a decline in everything, a decline in morals, a decline in teaching people the importance of certain things. He felt there were lots of crooked rulers everywhere and crooked business people, and nothing was as it should be. So he was very bothered by it, and he wanted to just change all that and make everything much, much better. Put the right people, Confucius said, put the right people there on the top, and everyone will follow them. Put the wrong people on the top, and everybody will leave the province and leave the little village and leave the towns. So he was a believer in that. Put the right leader on top of the country, a state, and then things will work out fine. Te, which is moral force, is needed to promote the good in society. And because Confucius delighted in tradition, he also delighted in a historical story of old. That story is talking about a battle, the battle in which the Qi and the Lu governments fought, and it took place in 560 BC. In that story, we learn of two righteous brothers. One was the oldest son of King Tan of the Shu sovereign. He renounced the throne in favor of his youngest brother. In Confucianism, renunciation is the virtue that leads to Te, which is moral power. So the two brothers, instead of fighting, taking up arms and hurting somebody, they didn't use power to solve their problems, but remained peaceful, and that was the right way for Confucius to do the right thing to solve problems. Confucius, in his private life, liked fishing, hunting, archery, music, and driving the chariot. When Confucius is in his 20s, his mother dies, and he retires for 3 years from public life. That he did to honor his mother, because he was very deep into ancestor worship, and ancestor worship also honored the dead, honored the old people, things like that. So he, when his mother died, felt he should retire from public life to really honor the death of his mother and to settle his thoughts and do other things. And that's what he did. He did that for 3 years. He was married, Confucius. He had a son and a daughter, but he outlived both of them. They died early in life. It clings. It doesn't come apart. So, Nothing is known about the wife of Confucius, but we know a little bit about the childhood of Confucius, that he was brought up in humble circumstances, but he had a good family. After the death of his mother, Confucius started to become a teacher of his own. He traveled around in states and towns to teach his philosophy. Around age 50, Confucius became a member of the upper regions of government, and around age 55, he even became prime minister. At the age of 55 to 68, he travels around in neighboring states in the hope to get his plan in effect, because he was not successful in his own state. Just like Plato had problems in Greece being accepted. In the time when Confucius lived, all over in the world, the philosophy movement started. According to my teacher, Confucianism is one of the most mature philosophies of the world. The teaching of Confucianism put importance on dependability, faithfulness, loyalty, truthfulness. Confucius was a teacher who became a sage, and all his disciples can be seen as a limb of the body of the sage, making one whole. There is Confucius, the sage in the middle, and the disciples surround him as a limb to the whole body. Sage, being Confucius, the profound philosopher, distinguished by his wisdom, and disciple, being the student, learning everything by listening to the sage. Confucius can be compared to Socrates in Greece, because both men didn't spend much time or a lot of thought about what is coming afterwards, meaning after death. Both men wanted to change society by building God's kingdom here on earth. They didn't want to wait till they died for the so-called paradise. They both thought, we have to do it while we are living here on earth. We have to do our best to make the best possible society for everyone to live in. It needs to be pointed out that later the Confucianism isn't the real thing anymore. Later, Confucianism changed into something that was elaborate, empty, and had meaningless rituals. We cannot make Confucius responsible for that, even though some followers later said that this was meant to be so because Confucius meant it so. Confucius was never a friend of elaborate, empty, and meaningless rituals. Quite the opposite. How something was meant and the departure of the real thing is something one needs to take into account, not only when studying Confucianism, but also studying all ancient writings, And that is true for all religious writings, also for the Christian writings. When we read the Bible, we always have to know that lots of different people wrote down the things that we later are finding as the truth in the Christian Bible. So when you study it, teachers tell you that you have to be careful because too many cooks making soup or making dinner, we know what that means, too many cooks putting their 5 cents in the soup and then it's too salty or not enough salt, you know what I mean. And that is true for all the ancient writings too, when there are many, many different people writing down so-called history, and then in the end you have to be careful when you read it, what is true, what is partly true, and what is maybe not true at all. So that said, might help when we read certain ancient things. When we have that in mind, then we can enjoy it because we don't take it maybe 100% as the truth in every little detail. Okay? There are many dynasties, but the one which later established Confucianism is the Han Dynasty. And this dynasty ruled from 200 BC to 200 AD. The Golden Age of China had certainly ideal rulers or emperors, and they had the needed virtues called Ling, which means non-activity. This non-activity in this sense here doesn't mean that the rulers were lazy, doing nothing. Non-activity in this sense means that one must let things unfold naturally by teaching goodness, then waiting for the person to become a better moral being. So non-activity is meant to give time for the seed to develop into that wonderful bloom or the wonderful tree or the wonderful human being. It needs time when you start planting a seed for a better life, a better society, a better world. And so non-activity is meant in that sense, to let things unfold naturally, to start it with some little help, but not to push it around or push it forward or push it in the direction that you want, but to very softly and unintentionally set the seed, plant the seed, and then wait for it to become what it needs to become. And they believe, those old ancient people, they believe that non-activity is the right thing, because in nature you cannot force nature either. You plant a seed and you hope it will become a tree one day, and if the weather is right and if the soil is good, then you become this perfect, wonderful tree. And the same is true for flowers, and the same, they felt, is true for human beings. If you want them to become moral human beings, good human beings, with integer thoughts and integer behavior, then you can give them a little bit help, but you have to be patient and wait till they too become that perfect human being, that or the closest to perfect human being. I think perfect is a little bit wrong to expect from human beings, but the best possible to perfect. Okay? The most important three rulers who did rule by Ling, which is non-activity, are Zhao, Zhu, and Zhu the Great. I don't know if I speak it out right. I hope so. If a Chinese person watches my channel, they laugh themselves silly, most likely. But I do my best. I can speak Chinese, so forgive me. Everyone who is watching and knows how to speak perfectly Chinese, forgive me for the wrong pronunciation. Thank you. Before Confucianism, there was ancestor worship in China. Ancestor worship was what the Chinese loved to follow. And now we come to the cultural heroes, or the mystical ancestors. There is Fu Xi, a serpent-bodied fellow who invented Chinese letters, fishnets, musical instruments, and he brought hunting and the domestication of animals to the Chinese people. Then there was Sheng Nuang, an ox-headed fellow who invented agriculture, medicine, and an ox-driven car. And the last one, Shuang Ti, also called Yellow Emperor, he invented bricks, vessels, both wood and clay vessels, boats, the calendar, money, and the silkworm culture. The silkworm culture was given to the Chinese people by the principal's wife. She did it. She found out about it and taught the people what to do with the silkworm to get silk. Because the Chinese back then were the first who had silk, and as we know, and they brought that to the world. Silk, the nice silk that some women like to wear, the expensive dresses, or the emperors, that is silk jackets and things like that. So that comes from the Chinese culture too. Main points of the teachings at the end, I want to talk quickly about it again to put everything under one whole list. The main points of teaching of Confucianism are traditions, ancestor worship, piety towards the dead, following rules and displaying right conduct set forth by the Way. Tao, spelled T-A-O, but pronounced Tao, runs through Chinese life. It's the proper way of living, and it is harmony. Kung Fu Chu is Confucius, and it means master. It took all in all 250 years for Confucianism to be established. So in the time of Confucius, when he lived, when he traveled around from province to province, from city to city, from state to state, from village to village, to introduce his thoughts and ideas, Confucianism was, of course, already his Confucianism, but it was not really traveling anywhere, but stayed in China in the books and in the writings. And only after 250 long years, then it became finally what we now know as Confucianism, but sadly, it's not the same Confucianism that was originally what Confucius wished to introduce to the world. It was watered down, or is watered down, and it changed too over the 250 years. People would maybe add things, maybe take things out and change the words and change the ideas. So all in all, it surely is still Confucianism, but we have to be careful when we study it today, if that is really as was meant by Confucius in any case, because traditions changed over 250 years. The people who later introduced Confucianism to their people maybe added things or took some liberties in talking about certain things, so that we always have to have in mind. But of course, it doesn't mean we shouldn't study it, because the main points are surely still in the book. When we read the Analects, we get a real thing and we get a feel for Confucius still. But over 250 years, we have to be careful when we read the things. How was that meant? Was it meant that way or that way? And things like that. And one shouldn't speculate and put things in the mouth of Confucius just to make it fit our own likes and dislikes. That's what they probably mean when they say you have to be careful when you interpret ancient writings, because things might get lost over time. And so we have to always be vigilant when we read it. And when we have a good idea how the man was, then we can also maybe say, I don't think that was really the idea of him. When we think it's off or too off or something like that, then we can say, I think that was a later interpretation. Okay? So, 250 years it took for Confucianism to be established. And it is also a holy book still in China. Even now, the Chinese people live under the communist regime. It is still the holy book in that sense that the Chinese people love to read it and love to follow it. The things that Confucius wanted people to do, to try to hang on to the morals and the things. So in that sense, he was successful, that he brought people something that they can follow, something that they can rely on to become a better human being and to establish it or take it over also in their private lives. If the system, the political system, is not following everything that a philosophy says, So can the private people still enjoy it and use it for meditation and for other things to make their life more, I would say, a little bit more worthy in a spiritual and meditative sense. Okay? So that was it. I hope you kind of liked it. The next video I make will be on Saturday, and it will be on Taoism. Taoism, Lao Tzu, and things like that. That is the man who came after Confucius. It's another system, but I try to contrast it to Confucianism when I do my next video, to show how times changed. Times always change, nothing stays the same, and that's true for Confucianism and Taoism too. The Taoists are completely, well, they are not completely, that's wrong too. They are still hanging on things from Confucius too, but they had other ideas, and they already changed a lot of things in the political spectrum. So it's kind of interesting to later see how history works, and how nothing stays the same, and how people really go from one thing to the next. Like now they have communism there, and before they had ancestor worship, and in other countries we saw it too. One time we have democracy, then we have some dictator who rules and things like that. So in that sense, it's interesting to see how people are changing things. It's always the people. People who come in and they become mighty and become rulers, then they suddenly can change a whole country to something completely new. And it's not always good. Sometimes it's good, but sometimes it's also not good. But that's the way it is. That's the way it works. And so I think it's kind of interesting to know that the world is a playground for all kinds of things and all kinds of adventurous things, in the good as in the bad. Okay? So, next video will be about Taoism, and there are also books and writings, and I will do it on Saturday, because on Friday I work almost the whole day. I'm gone in the mornings, then I come home for a little bit, then I go and see some person in my neighborhood that I go shopping for her to the grocery store. And I'm not the whole afternoon at her place going shopping for her, but it's in a funny time when I go to her. She only wants to come here at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. So I'm shopping from 3 to 4 o'clock. When I'm done at her place, it's 4 o'clock. Then I come home and it's 4:30 or shortly before 5. And then the light is already not good. And I'm just sitting here now because the light is so bright in my living room. When I do it, then the whole video is awful, I think, from the color. And so today I was forced to sit here with the light too, but it's not as bad as in my living room. But I like to do the video, if possible, I like to do it with daylight, because I think it's better. It doesn't have the reflection in my reading classes and things like that. And so it's also a better video to watch for everybody. And that's why I try to do it over the daytime. And on Saturday, I have time, I can do it in the morning hours, in the early or later morning, and then I can sit in the daylight and do it, which is much more enjoyable for me too. So that's the reason, okay? So on Saturday, I try to do it in the morning, so I can maybe upload it around 12 o'clock or so, or the early afternoon for you all to see, okay? So I hope that was today kind of interesting, and I hope I'm on the right path now to make my channel a little bit more interesting by really teaching things, because things like world religion, I think, are interesting when we learn about Hinduism, Sikhism, Jainism, about Buddhism, about Judaism, about Christianity. Then we can also see what is common in all the religions, and there are lots of common things in many religions, but there are also many things they are totally different. But it is interesting from that sense. You do not need to have to be religious. It's like a historical study, of the human condition. I would call it a normal study on the human condition, because it's the humans who make it all the way it is. We humans, we make the religion to what the religion becomes. It's not a thing that comes by itself. There was one time, there was maybe a holy man or a sage or somebody who thought they were spiritually special, and they then said, I make my own religion, and then they would write things down, then others, disciples, would also write things down with the man or the woman, and then it became, in the end, one long, long story of a certain era. It starts with all stories. Somebody writes something down, and they add something, and then the little story becomes the big story. So if we look at religion that way, that it is a story told by human beings in a different era, in a different country, in a different time, in a different mood of the person who wrote it down, who made it to be a religion or a movement of a religion, then the whole thing becomes more interesting, because we always have to have in mind it's written by human beings. It's written by human beings who once thought they had a certain important thought to share with the world. This is how it usually starts. Somebody like Buddha resting under a tree and then having the feeling he is enlightened. He wants to share his enlightenment with the rest of the world. And so, then when we look at it that way, and we all certainly sat under a tree and dreamed about things, then we see it all of a sudden with more understanding and sympathy, because sometimes people get really annoyed when somebody talks about religion and they do not want to listen, because for them it's all nonsense, for them it's all that crazy thing and things like that. But if we look at it like a spiritual quest, that became a religious movement, then it's all of a sudden a little bit different. Okay, so this is maybe what we should consider And then we do not close our ears right away and say, I don't care for that stuff, I don't want to hear it, because it's also important insofar that we all are somewhat affected by it, if we want it or not. We are affected by religion too, because it's part of the whole picture. We cannot just leave it out completely, because it doesn't matter if we believe in religion, but we certainly all believe in some things. If we believe in, let's say, what could it be? What could I give from thing? If we believe in nature and the power of nature, like storms and the weather conditions and things like that, then in my opinion, we are already walking into spirituality. Some people might say, I'm overdoing it, and that is not spirituality. This is just maybe thinking about weather, and that's all. There's nothing more to it. But I say, if you go out in nature and you look at trees and you contemplate certain things, how old the tree is and why is the tree at this particular place, and why does this tree grow so nicely? The soil might be good for the tree, or the place, the sunshine and everything might be good for the tree. If you think like that about a tree, then you are spiritual. You are spiritual because you think deeply about things that are on earth, and we all share it. We all share nature. We all share weather, sunshine. We all look at the moon and we think certain things when we look at the moon. We look at the stars at night. We are happy when we see an ocean. We see an ocean and the waves come in, and we love to see the sand on the beach and walk there barefoot on the beach and things like that. That is all spiritual. That is all spiritual. It's not much different from religious writings, because they too just tell stories. They tell stories, but they also have interrelationships in those stories of people, of disciples meeting the master, no matter who the master is. It can be Buddha, it can be Jesus, it can be Muhammad, it can be whoever it is. There's always a master and lots of disciples. That's what religion is when it comes down to it. A master and followers. A master and followers. The master, he is the enlightened one trying to teach the rest of us some belief in some stories. That's all it is. He teaches us, she teaches us a belief in the stories of humankind. So I hope that with that in mind, I get a few people who come to my channel with an open mind and want to listen to the stories that I want to tell you all. Okay, so I see you on Saturday when we continue with the Oriental way of looking at things. And then, I don't know what will be next, but first we finish up with the Taoism. Okay? So I see you on Saturday, and thank you very much for listening. Thank you very much for visiting my channel. thank you very much to be patient with me and give me a chance to grow and become better over time. So thank you. I love you all. Have a good night and till Saturday. Bye.